this here, okay. So it's an honor. I hope that this title is not, will turn out to be not as mysterious as it looks at the first glance, but I will try to explain it. So, let me show these pictures. Three people in eyeglasses, and apparently soon they will be 70 years old, which really came as a shock to me. This is, I can't believe that they are only 70. So let me tell you why. So when in 1977 I joined this institute, then Gábor Fejestolt and Endre Makkai were already established mathematicians, established leaders in discrete mathematics, in discrete geometry. So for me, they were at least one generation above me. But you know, at that age, you count generations as kind of university generations. So one generation above you is a person who you still attended university at the same time, but there were several years between them. But I mean, we never attended Ötvös University at the same time. So I was 10 years old when Gábor Fejestolt published his first paper in Elemente der Mathematik. By the time I joined the institute, he had 15 papers, published papers. I checked it in the MathSciNet that who were those people who were definitely well aware of his activities because they reviewed his papers. Among them I found Erdős, Grömer, Bamba, Hadwiger, and other leaders of the field. Meanwhile, Bandi arrived. He was also an established leader in discrete geometry. He had 9 papers published by 1977. Actually, I was 12 years old when he for the first time won first prize on the Schweizer competition. And it was quite amazing how broad his knowledge of mathematics was and still is, because apart from discrete geometry, he published papers in general algebra, in about Banach spaces, topology, and he keeps publishing in these fields. Again, there are some luminaries who reviewed his papers. Among those who reviewed his papers, I found Joan Isbell, the legendary Joan Isbell from Princeton, and Anatoly Maltzer, who the older of you may remember. And then here is the other person who should also, he was also one generation older, Tibor Bistritsky. Well, how old he was in 1977, I can only tell you that at that time he had already had spent 21 years in Canada, and at that time he used to be Ted. And his thesis, PhD thesis, was published in, I think he defended it in 75 or 76. 75, yes. So these are the birthday boys, and I was really wondering how, you know, how you can hit three birds by one stone. And Actually, I don't know if you realize that, I put a lot of effort and time in this because all the pictures you can find on the internet has only two birds with a stone, but finally I managed. And then I came up with this idea that one thing that they definitely have in common is that all three of them worked on covering problems. So, I cannot list their most important works in this field, so I just decided to remind you of three problems in this area that they asked, and then all of these questions you will see are more or less open. And then I will talk a little bit more about one of the questions, the third question, which grew out of this joint paper with Ender Makai, to whom I am especially grateful because I really learned a lot from him, in particular all of the methods that are used in this paper. I heard from him for the first time the Brum-Minkowski inequality, which is probably my fault. Okay, so these are the three papers where the problems were asked. So let's start with the first one. This is a problem, famous problem, to which Ted Bistritsky, Tibor Bistritsky contributed a lot. This is Hadwiger's covering problem. Surely most of you will know. It's a very simply formulated problem. The problem is that you take a d-dimensional convex body and you call a homothetic copy of this body. If you take this body and you sort of shrink it by a factor smaller than one, and but without tilting it. And the conjecture is that every d-dimensional convex body can be covered by at most 2 to the d smaller homothetic copies. Of course, if this conjecture is true, then this is best possible, as shown by the cube, because if you take a smaller homothet of the cube, then obviously one smaller homothet can cover only one of the vertices of the cube. But there is a lot of work concerning this problem. In fact, as it's very common in mathematics, it's called Hadwiger's covering conjecture, but it was first asked by Levy in 1955. Hadwiger only asked the same question in 57, and apparently it was independently asked also by Gochbert and Marcus, and it's really a very appealing conjecture. Some of you may have heard it in a slightly different form, which is equivalent to the original one, and which was popularized and or discovered by Boltyansky in 1960. And that form is that if you take a d-dimensional convex body, then you can illuminate it, its surface, by at most 2 to the d light sources. So what is the relationship of Ted Bistritsky to this conjecture? There are lots of things known about it. One of the most interesting facts was proved by Károly Bezdeg and Ted Bistritsky in 1997, after one only partially successful attempt a little bit earlier by them. Namely, you would think that based on this construction, that the number of vertices is a lower bound for for the number of smaller homothetic copies you need. So if this conjecture is not true, then perhaps you can come up with some construction in three dimensions which has more vertices. And an obvious sort of possible counterexample is the dual or polar of the cyclic polytope, which has the largest number of edges in every dimension. And what they proved, that actually the conjecture is true for the polar of the cyclic polytope. It's a very nice piece of work, and I warmly recommend to everybody reading it. Now, the next one is a conjecture which was asked by Gábor Fejestót and Peter Gritzmann. And it has a very strange, in fact, I would say a rather ugly name. But this is also not unusual in mathematics. So to understand this name, you really have to know the history of the problem. So in fact, there is a famous conjecture which I don't want to state, partially solved by László Fejestót, which was called the sausage conjecture. And then it had a form which was called the sausage skin conjecture, and this is the dual of it. But in spite of this ugly name, the problem and the conjecture is very simple and very elegant. So what is the conjecture? Take a d-dimensional convex body of the largest possible surface area, skin. This is where the skin comes from, such that its boundary can be covered by n unit balls. So this is here clearly, if you look at this strange rectangular, almost rectangular convex set, which on the left side and the right side is bounded by two circular arcs, clearly its boundary can be covered by n unit disks. And so the conjecture is that actually, so this is what Fejestót, László Fejestót would call a sausage-like configuration. The conjecture is that this is the convex body of larger surface area which has this property. Now, Gábor and Peter Gritzmann managed to prove this thing in the plane. In the plane, actually, in this configuration, one can also calculate that how far those the centers of the disks should be from each other, and it is a very elegant proof. In higher dimensions, it's really unclear how to proceed, and one can come up with some kind of asymptotic estimates, but the problem is really wide open. One of the difficulties, as you can imagine, is that if you take n unit balls and their arrangement, their union, it's not so easy to tell that what would be the largest surface area, or as a matter of fact, the largest volume convex body that you can inscribe in it. And I think that this is somehow the major difficulty here, and if someone managed to crack this problem, then one should face this difficulty. By the way, Imre, 5 minutes before I should finish, could you raise your hand? Okay, thank you. So now we come to the third conjecture. For this we need a definition. So what is a slab, or it's also known as trip or plank? In the d-dimensional space, you take two parallel hyperplanes and whatever is in between. So in the plane, it is really like a parallel strip. And obviously the distance between these two hyperplanes, this is what is called the width of the slab. And the conjecture of Bondi and myself from 1983, which is also open, is the following, that if you have a sequence of slabs with total widths, divergent total widths, the sum of these widths is infinite, then you can individually translate those slabs so as to cover the d-dimensional space. I have an illustration for that too. So here you see three strips, and you can translate these strips so that they cover this unit ball. I mean, I couldn't come up with an example in which I mean you can see that how to cover the whole space. But so here, as you see, the conjecture is stated in such a way that if the total width is infinite, then you cover the unit ball. In fact, it's equivalent. Because if with total width infinite, with infinite total width, you can cover the unit ball, then with some of them you can cover the unit ball, with some of them you can cover the ball of radius 2, radius 3, and so on. So altogether, you can cover the whole space. There was also a very nice proof by Imre Ruzsa, showing that if here, in this form of the conjecture, it works that with infinite total width, you can cover the unit ball, then actually there also exists a constant, so that if the total width of the slabs is at least that constant, then you can also translate the slabs so as to cover the unit ball. Now, this conjecture, as I said, is still open, and one of the special cases when at that time in 1983 we couldn't solve whether the slabs can cover the whole space is when you have slabs of width 1, 1 half, 1 third, and so on, the harmonic sequence. But that, not long ago, Andrei Kupavsky and myself managed to prove. Well, this is the exact theorem, but I don't want to say much about it. I'd like to say something about slightly more recent developments. So, in the same paper, we introduced a notion. We call that controlling function classes. I am not sure that it was such a good title, really. But let me try to explain it. So I think that today I would rather say that I would use the expression that simultaneous approximation of functions. So let me try to draw a picture, although there will be another picture on the next slide. So imagine that we have some functions, any kind of functions, a lot of functions. For instance, you can think of linear functions, lines, or you can think of polynomials of degree d, or you can think of Lipschitz functions, or whatever. So you take a class of functions. For the picture, I am using just this simplest case when the functions are from the real numbers to the real numbers. Although later it will be slightly different. And we take a sequence of values, x1, x2, and so on, x3, an infinite sequence. And we say that this is a controlling sequence, if you can find a point above x1, point, let's call this point x1, y1, a point above x2, x2, y2, and so on, so that no matter which function of your class you take, you can find one of these points which comes reasonably close to this function. What is reasonably close? Smaller than or equal to 1. So this is our problem was that we try to characterize those sequences, x1, x2, xn, for which we can find values y1, y2, and so on, so that the points x1, y1, x2, y2, and so on, all together come close to every function in the function class. So this may look like a somewhat artificial question, but surprisingly, it leads to interesting consequences, and it raises interesting questions. So the first example is this example when we consider the linear functions, lines, and we have the sequence x1, x2, and as before, you would like to find points xi, yi above them, so that for every line, we can find one of these points which is close to that. In this case, this one is. Now, what we did, we actually managed to prove that there is a very simple condition for the members of this sequence. Of course, I assume that these are positive numbers. That doesn't make much difference. So a sequence is controls all the linear functions if and only if the sum of the reciprocals of these numbers is infinite, divergent. And in fact, the way how we prove it is that we discover that this statement here is equivalent to that translative covering conjecture with trips that I mentioned before in the planar case, and in the planar case, we managed to prove that. So this was a success for our first example. So what was the second example? In the second example, we weren't completely successful. So our second example is when the class of functions is the polynomials of degree d. In that case, we made the conjecture very similar to the previous conjecture or theorem, linear case, that a sequence is controls all polynomials of degree d, if and only if the sum of the reciprocals of the d's powers is infinite. Now, we were unable to prove this, but what we realized that if we knew the answer to the translative covering conjecture, the covering conjecture with slabs that I started with, then this conjecture would follow. And again, in the same paper with Andrei Kupavsky, we actually managed to prove this statement, however, without settling the covering conjecture with slabs. As a matter of fact, I don't know how Bundy feels about it, but today I am not completely convinced that this conjecture is true. At that time, I think I believed in it more, but there is some difficulty which is hard to explain. So there was a third example that we looked at, and with this example, we didn't have much success. We proved what we were able to prove, and this was in fact the occasion at which I learned from Bandy the Brum-Minkowski inequality, which plays an important role in the proof. So if we look at the Lipschitz functions, and now we can consider it more generally, the question. So we look at all Lipschitz functions that are from the line, from the one-dimensional space to the d-dimensional space. So you imagine that if you want, then the two-dimensional space here, for instance, then these Lipschitz functions would be kind of Lipschitz curves in three space. And what we are interested in, again, the same thing, that in which cases can we find for a sequence x1, x2, x3. Now, points y1, y2, y3, and so on in the plane, or in the d-dimensional space, so that altogether these points come close to every Lipschitz function. And what we managed to prove is that if a sequence is controlling, then there is a density condition that should be satisfied. And that density condition is that if you look at how many xi's have absolute value smaller than n, then if you divide that by n to the d, then the supremum of that should be infinity. This is a sort of necessary condition. We formulated it in a sort of less elegant way, but essentially what we did was equivalent to that. And the recent result that I'd like to mention here is that together with Gábor Pardos and Andrei Kupavsky, recently we managed to show that, in fact, this condition is also sufficient for a sequence to be Lipschitz controlling. And I have to show you the next transparency, not in the hope that you would profit anything from it, but so there is a proof. It only shows that the proof is kind of constructive, but I have to show it to you because, although maybe it doesn't show, but I worked a lot on this illustration, which would illustrate the proof. So somehow, I think that the idea, so first idea is obvious, that instead of controlling all Lipschitz functions, we control those Lipschitz functions for which the Lipschitz constant is 1, and at 0, the value of the function is within a cube of side lengths 1, and those for which the Lipschitz constant is 2, and the value at 0 is in the 2 by 2 cube, and so on. And for each of them, if we manage to control, then it is controlling. And for one particular example, we kind of managed to build a wall which is impossible to avoid. You are not supposed to understand what I'm saying, but I didn't have the guts to remove this beautiful picture. Now, so the next question, which we already raised in that paper with Bandy, was that what happens if we look at Lipschitz functions not from x, from the one-dimensional line to the d-dimensional space, but for the m-dimensional space to the d-dimensional. And there is a very simple corollary. The corollary is that in fact, if we know that the sequence is RM RD, so the Lipschitz controlling from the n dimensional to the d dimensional space, then this condition should be satisfied. The same condition as in the case m equals 1. That's kind of obvious from the definition. So assume that you have a sequence which is RM, RD controlling. So here is a picture. So this means that that for x1 you can find y1. So imagine that m is equal to 2. So you have a Lipschitz function from the two-dimensional space to the d-dimensional space. So assume that that the function is Lipschitz controlling, then you can find y1 and y2 in the plane, so that x, y1, y, x, x2, y2, and so on come close to every Lipschitz function. And what we do is the following, that now we move each of these values x1 to the x-axis. Here there is x2, we move it to the x-axis, then we get a point whose absolute value is the same as the absolute value of the original point, and we also move the values y1 and y2 and so on above it. Now, these points in the plane would be if they are controlling, then they should be controlling. And if this condition here is not satisfied, then it is possible to avoid this. In the plane, it is possible to avoid these points which are above the r-axis. It is possible to avoid by a Lipschitz function. And then we simply take this Lipschitz function and we turn it around this axis. And then we get another Lipschitz function, and if the original Lipschitz function over the line avoided these points here, then the sort of rotated function one dimension higher will also avoid the original points. It's really essentially follows from the definition. And we made a conjecture with Andrei Kupavsky and Gábor Tardos that actually this condition is also sufficient for a sequence to be MRD controlling. For some technical reasons, you have to assume that M is smaller than or equal to D. We were unable to prove this conjecture. However, this is the right conjecture, and instead of this conjecture in that paper, we made a wrong conjecture. I don't know if you remember that. We made a very similar conjecture. The only difference is that that conjecture is not true. It would take some time to explain it. But this conjecture seems to be true. Or at least we don't have a counterexample for that. In fact, we have a theorem which kind of indicates that the conjecture is not completely foolish. So we prove the statement under a stronger condition. So the stronger condition is the following. So assume that a sequence satisfies the following property, that if you take any, there comes a density condition for those points that x1, x2 that are in the m-dimensional space. The density condition is the following, that for every x in the m-dimensional space, And let's put it the other way. For every alpha, there exists a constant C depending on alpha, so that no matter how you take a point X in the n-dimensional space, and you consider that how many xi's are in the neighborhood of radius alpha of this point x, then this number will be at least the absolute value of x to the power of d minus m, provided that x is far enough from the, x is large enough, far enough from the origin. So if this condition is satisfied, then we manage to prove and that the sequence is Lipschitz controlling. It's kind of an interesting proof. Somehow it boils down to using Brouwer's fixed point theorem. We don't have a proof that wouldn't use some kind of topology. And as I mentioned, this is a stronger condition. By a simple counting argument, we can show that if this condition is satisfied, then also the previous condition, density condition, is also satisfied, namely for every n, number of points xi divided by whose absolute value is smaller than n divided by n to the d, the supremum of it is infinity. So the conjecture is that to try to prove exactly the same statement with the simpler assumption. Now, I think that it doesn't make sense to sort of indicate how topology comes into the picture. So instead of that, I show you another picture. I was looking for a picture where all three of the birthday boys are present. So I found this picture from 10 years ago. From Hoboken, where there was a conference. I don't know if you see anything strange about the picture. You can see that Ted and Bondi and Gabor didn't change at all. The only person who changed is me. So anything strange? Well, yeah, I guess that there is something strange, at least to me it seemed to be strange, that Bondi is actually taller on this picture than Gabor is. But this has a good reason. Actually, I couldn't find such a picture where all three of them were present. So this was done by the artist, Balázs Keszeg. Yes? This was Hoboken. Hoboken, New Jersey. In fact, I think that Bondi was not present. But I thought that you would notice that he's so much taller. I mean, he's a great mathematician, but not that high, not that tall. So we experimented a little bit with that. So maybe David Larman. So maybe this is the better picture. I don't know. The artist actually preferred the first picture, but it's hard to tell. Anyway, I am raising my imaginary glass to the health of these three great mathematicians and good friends I hope that we will have a chance to collaborate for a long time to come. Many happy returns.